I told you I was going to bring you back a surprise, a wonderful surprise, a sweet surprise. I brought you Patricia Williams from District Restaurant in New York. And Patricia, today you're going to show us something wonderful, a dessert. What is they going to make for us?
This is called clafoutis. It is one of my favorite desserts.
Would you repeat the name alone?
Clafoutis.
I must say, you just the way you say it, you bring to this such a sweetness, a natural wonderfulness that I must know about it. What is it again?
It's a very simple dessert with a very complicated name, and you can... It has so many variations you can use. And it's my favorite dessert because it was the first dessert I ever had when I went to Paris for the very first time.
So it has a very symbolic value to it.
Very, very symbolic.
But do you think that people at home can, you know, usually when we think of French desserts, we always think of complicated, heavy-duty creams and reductions and things of the sort. Is this something that just about anyone at home can do?
Anyone at home. It only has 5 ingredients to it.
5?
5. That's it.
Okay.
It's an incredible...
I have to see this. So you guide me through it. I'll be your assistant. You tell me exactly what it is, and I see a selection of fruit. Go on. You take
and
it over
from here. And the versatility of this. You can use anything in season, but now we have stone fruits. You have this beautiful nectarine, some pluots, apricots, red plums. Down here you have some cherries. You can use all of these, one of these, or if it's strawberry season, pineapple season. In France, they always use cherries. The pits have not been taken out of.
No?
No. It's a dessert from Brittany. It's wonderful. I think we'll take the pits out of this one.
I think we should try that. Yes, yes. I can see lawsuits coming down the hill.
No, none of that. None of that.
Now, you're very comfortable with the way you're talking about the fruit. And I must say, after so many years working in the kitchen myself, one of the things that I'm ignorant about is myself to be able to pick the best fruit. When you're looking at these fruits, what are some of the insights that you can give to our friends at home? What to look for?
One of the things you always want to do is smell it.
Okay.
I mean, if it has a wonderful aroma to it, and you can go into, when you go to the market, you can really smell the peaches, or when you go by the pineapples, you smell the pineapples. So that's one of the first things you do, is to smell it. Then you want to make sure it's not too hard, a bit of firmness to it, not too soft. No spots.
That's a very important part, and you're making a point. You glimmer when you say it on the not too soft side, because one of the falsehoods about fruit, I think sometimes when they say, oh, if it's soft, it's ripe, it's ready to be eaten out, that's not necessarily true when it comes to
this.
And
sometimes it's not, and particularly peaches, the area I grew up in, you would have peaches and you would just be like drooling the juice all down your chin. It was delicious. It was one of my most favorite things. That, any kind of melon, being from that very warm Texas.
You're from Texas?
I'm a Texas girl.
Well, I got to say, I would not have guessed that. I would not have guessed that. But well, let's go on, because I don't want to hold you back. So we have this wonderful fruit before us. Once you collect all this bounty of freshness, what is the next thing that you do?
Well, we're going to start the recipe. I'm just going to move these over here a bit.
All right.
And as I say, the recipe is very simple. We're going to take some softened butter, room temperature. That's important to me.
Absolutely.
That,
right away, madam.
And we're going to go into our blender here.
Yes.
And then confectionate sugar. Some people refer to it as 10X. And we're going to put that into it as well. Then always start the mixer low.
Mm-hmm.
Otherwise, we're going to have powdered sugar all over us.
Yes, might not be so difficult for you, but I'm wearing black, and you know
right.
How many times I've actually been accused of looking like Santa Claus? For many reasons, but...
And again, this is a very simple recipe. You're just combining them till it's a little bit fluffy.
That's... Now, if you don't have such a gifted machine as this, what would you suggest for people at home to
I would use just a regular whisk or a fork. The
okay.
way one made pastries years ago, when you would...
Because it's something of old,
know,
long
absolutely.
Before people had these incredible
or
machines.
Your two hands work very, very well.
Now, when you're using your hands, because the butter is softened up, you want to wait it even softer than what you put it in, almost to cream-like consistency
yes.
before you
so
use it?
So it's nice and creamy. Otherwise, it won't have, if it's too hard, it won't dissolve properly. So it has a lot of, you'll have a lot of lumps. And that looks really good there.
This is the consistency we like to have?
That's the consistency we have.
Okay, let me disengage it. Let me tell you, what else can I do next to help you with this?
Okay, we're going to add the almond flour.
Almond flour.
Now, I like, some recipes for clafoutis call for regular flour. I prefer the almond flour because it adds a little bit of texture to it.
Forgive me for a moment. I'm listening spellbound, and there are two things that I love about this. One is the way in which you talk about things. You have an inner elegance that does not come from being a chef. There must be more to your story than just being a chef. So I need to ask you, what were you before you were a chef?
I was a professional ballet dancer. And I moved from Texas.
Now, ballet dancer, we are accustomed to think as very delicate things. You survive in a kitchen as a ballet dancer?
Oh, you think we're just little, very, very meek people? No, 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 no.
Very difficult.
Very
strenuous.
Very strenuous. Very, very sophisticated. You have to. The head goes here. The eyes go there. The feet go there. You turn over there. You run around twice. You do this. You jump as high as you can, and you land on one foot.
But now, you injure yourself,
yes.
I assume.
Yes.
And, I mean, working in a kitchen is not easy. I mean, obviously, it's not as pirouetting, it's not as as demanding on the type of exercising that you do, but nevertheless, you're on your feet all day long. There are ungodly hours, as we all well
right.
know.
But you have 2 feet, and you don't have to go on point. So
and how
it's
did
much
you start?
Easier.
How did you start? I mean, it was right on the line, or you kind of work your way from the front of the house to the back of the house?
Actually, when I came back from France, I decided that I wanted to be a chef. So what I did was I went to the only 3-star American restaurant ever to exist, and I said, this is what I know how to do, and I was hired immediately.
What is that you knew how to make at that point?
Nothing.
At least you were truthful.
No. My
how
job...
many people fudge, you know, their resumes
right, no,
just to get
no,
a job?
No,
you
no,
actually
no,
said the truth.
I can't do anything. So my first job was to put things on a plate, desserts. I couldn't make them. I couldn't do anything. I could only take the dessert, design it, and put it on the plate.
I know the people watching at home, they must be upset with me because, you know, Nick, I was writing this down that she's telling what to do and you're stopping it. My fault. Why don't we continue? You were talking about, but by the way, that is fascinating. Well, I must know more about this later. This is the almond flour you were
right.
saying.
If you don't have almond flour, you can make it in a Roboco yourself.
Okay.
Just add a little bit of flour to some almonds
okay.
and pulse it. Otherwise, if you over mix it, you're going to end up with almond butter,
perfect.
Which is quite good, but it's not for
but it's
for
not
this.
What we want to use. It's like yes. peanut butter, almost
right.
a variation.
Again,
it.
We're going to put the almond flour in here.
Here, I'll hold this for you.
Thank you. And we'll start the blender off slowly.
All
so
right.
again, we don't have almond flour all over us. So,
well, of course, it would help if I was to lift this.
I'll take the bowl.
You fluster me. You fluster me.
So you're just basically mixing that together. You don't want to overmix it, but you just mix it together. You can see how it's coming together.
Wonderfully
and the
well.
Consistency is really very nice. So I think we can take that out of the bowl, turn it off now.
Okay.
And could you please hand me those eggs?
Right away.
Thank you. Now we're going to take the eggs and add cream to it. And just with a whisk, you're just going to whisk it in.
Okay. Should I disengage this now?
Yes, please. Oh, I'll hand you the whisks, spatula.
Here I am. Let me put this away over here. Actually, I'll do the spatula, I'll hold it, and you can pull it in.
Okay.
So you do it at the amount that you like.
You can do it in the mixer if you like, but I always liked. I think
this
desserts,
is more of an interaction.
It
this
is,
way.
It is. And you get the feel of it. We're just going to do a little bit of it at a time. You get the feel of the batter, too. You don't want to. One of the things people make a mistake in pastries is overmixing.
Overmixing things, yes.
You know, particularly any kind of flour because the gluten in it. And like pancake batter, anything like that, people overmix it.
When you're working with a machine, there's always the temptation of putting it up to the next speed to get it
right,
faster.
Right.
And then when as a result, it not necessarily is the result that we want to begin with.
Absolutely. So then we're just going to finish putting the rest of this in. Oops.
Oh, don't worry. That's just exactly what happens to me at home when I try to get involved with this.
Okay, I'll give you the spatula
perfect.
Back.
I'll move this away.